chosen, I love this version that you chose of 1 Corinthians 13, and I'll read this to you now. Love is always patient. Love is always kind. Love is never envious or arrogant with pride, nor is she conceited. She is never rude. She never thinks just of herself or ever gets annoyed. She never is resentful, is never glad with sin. She always is glad to side with the truth, and pleased the truth will win. She bears up under everything, believes the best in all. There is no limit to her hope, and she will never fall. Love never fails. Lofty words, incredible challenge. It is true about love, it is not so true about us. We do fall, we do have struggles, and so that's why we also have to make commitments. Commitments to this ideal of love that you have today. Falling in love, that's why we use the verb falling, because you don't need any skill to fall in love, you just do it. You suddenly, life does what life does, and you fall in love with each other. But today, you're doing something that's so important. You're saying that out of all the people in the world, I think we're up to 7 billion now in our world, you're saying that I'm going to choose you today, and I'm going to choose you for the rest of my life. Today, tomorrow, no matter what happens, I'm going to continue to choose you, even when that choice is easy, and even when that choice is difficult. Because it's what creates a family. This is the fundamental building block for all of our families. Another definition of love that I like is from a Jesuit, John Powell. He says that when the satisfaction, security, and development of another person become as important to me as my own satisfaction, security, and development, that's when love exists. And so you're committing not just to love this day, but also the act of love to make sure that the other person's life is as full as it possibly can be. That becomes one of your goals. It's one of the first times we ever truly become less self-centered when we say the other person's life is important too. The poet B.F. Mays wrote this poem that I just found again, and I wanted to share it with you. It's called Holy September Sabbath Morning. He wrote this after watching a couple renew their vows on their 50th wedding anniversary. And so, I know it's a little early to think about your 50th, but I want you to imagine that this is the goal. It's called Holy September Sabbath Morning. When, on that Holy September Sabbath Morning, we, together, you and I, locked our lives, I promised through all the ripe and painted autumns to walk with you. Through bleak and icy winters, I vowed to cuddle with you. Throughout the fresh and resurrecting springs, I took an oath to accompany you, and I swore to love you through all the green and sunlit summers. Now on this late September 7th evening, our lives still locked, I renew my promise, I restate my vow, I reaffirm my oath, and with the sincerity of a pristine priest, prostrate, black frock cloaked in holy ceremony to swear to love his God, I do swear once again to love you, yes, even longer than forever. These promises that you make today are big, but you don't make them in isolation. You make them in the context of these people who love you. So I'm going to let them do it first. Would you face out over here and see these people who are all smiling at you? See them here? You don't want to just see the backs of their heads the whole time. Look how beautiful they are. This is your chance. I'm going to ask you to make a vow before they make their vows. It's the context in which their vows make sense. I'm going to ask you, will you promise to support Richie and Grace in their marriage together? Will you choose the marriage and not when they have troubles? And I know it's hard to imagine that they will, but everyone does. When they have fights, will you not side with one or the other, but you'll side with the marriage? And will you also promise to pray for them and to support them for the rest of their marriage life together? If so, say, we will.
We will.
There you go. Eternity. And so now, with that as your context, with God as your support, now you make your vows. And so, with your promises, I invite you to bind yourselves to one another as husbands. invites you up to the altar. Richard, do you take Grace to be your wife, to live together in the estate of marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others be faithful to her so long as you both shall live, if so say I do? Grace, do you take Richard to be your husband, to live together in the estate of marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others be faithful to him so long as you both shall live? And I invite you to come forward and to make your promises before God and this assembly. Time. Grace and Richard will be lighting the unity candle. It's a symbol of their two bright lights that they are in their lives now joining together and creating a third light that is supposed to also represent their home, and that these home lights are places for hospitality and welcome. So I invite you. Thank you. reception will begin immediately over in the lounge. Please join us.